I would like to thank Dr. Pratibha Singh for having me here, and thank you, chairpersons. So, I was told to speak about aneuploidy screening, and I was particularly told that, you know, the ultrasound-based screening would be covered by Dr. Girish. So, I haven't really, I won't be talking much about the 11 to 14-week scan. So, I will be talking about the biochemistry screening. Now, all of you are obstetricians here, or some radiologists also? All obstetricians? Obstetricians, how many? Okay, and there are a few radiologists here? Okay, that's nice. So, when you talk about aneuploidy screening, so I'd just like to know if Down syndrome screening is being offered to everybody. Yeah, are we routinely doing dual markers? Everybody? Okay, that's great. So, I think the use, first of all, obviously we should be knowing what to do, and obviously, more importantly, how to interpret. So, I hope that, you know, what are we going to talk is going to help in clinical practice. So, Down syndrome, when we are talking about aneuploidy screening, it's majorly the Down syndrome that we are talking about. So, some of the questions that come to our mind is, you know, why should we screen? Who should we screen? Or how to do the screening, and if the screen results come positive, what should we do, and how to tell the patient. We all know that Down syndrome is like one of the most common aneuploidies that we see in clinical practice, and for all practical purposes, the test that we are doing is to detect aneuploidies and majorly Down syndrome. There are severe mental and physical disabilities, and we would like to at least, you know, be prepared if a baby is having Down syndrome. Now the next question is, who should we screen? So should we do screening for everybody, or we should do only high risk screening? Yes, everybody. High risk? Everybody. Yes, so I think it is now very clear that we should be offering routine aneuploidy screening before 20 weeks of gestation to everybody. Because what happens is that if we only take the high risk women, we would be losing out on 80% of the women who are carrying actually a baby with the Down syndrome. So I think universal screening is the norm, and you should offer some form of screening to everybody depending on when the patient is come. Some of the basic things about screening. So there's something called a priori risk, which is the background risk with respect to the age. Right? So because the mother is 35 years of age, she has some background risk. Adjusted risk is when you multiply that priori risk with the additional factors which have been derived from the screening test. So when we apply screening test to a particular population, you expect that you're going to detect, say, 100 people, out of which one would be having the actual aneuploidy. So screening is not a diagnostic test. A diagnostic test is a situation when you are able to detect the exact person who's going to have. Why this is important is when we are counseling that patient, we have people who come to us and say, my Down screen test is positive, I want to terminate the pregnancy. So, you know, that is the kind of situation that does arise very commonly. So when we are actually offering a test, there is something called a pre-test counseling which should be done, that this is just a screening test, this should be followed by a diagnostic test. So screening versus diagnostic test, the diagnostic test has no overlap. The diagnostic test has no either positive or negative. However, the screening test will have overlaps in which the test positives will be negatives and the test negatives will be positive. There is currently no ideal screening test, but we would want to be as ideal as possible. Certain important terminology with respect to screening test and serum biochemistry is multiples of median. It tells how close a patient value is to the median value for that week of pregnancy. So what happens is, even if you get the test done at 11 weeks, the absolute value does not matter, because you're going to say that for, say, any 11 weeks pregnancy, what is my MOM, my value with respect to the standard value? So 0.5 MOM would mean that PAP A is half as much as it should usually be, or 2.5 means that it would be twice the value that you expect at that gestation. So it provides a uniformity for interpretation of your values. So when you talk about the spectrum of screening, then there you have the first trimester serum screening, then you do the ultrasound and you have the first trimester combined screening, You have NIPT, which ranges from first trimester to second trimester to third trimester. And then you have the second trimester diagnostic test or a first trimester diagnostic test, which is CVS and amniocentesis. Talking about the biochemical screening, we have the triple test, which is AFP with estriol with HCG and inhibin, which forms the quadruple test. In the first trimester, you have the PAP and free beta HCG. What we need to know is that for all practical purposes, if possible, let's not do the triple test. Okay? So what we do you offer quadruple to everybody? If patients are coming late, are we offering quadruple? Are labs offering? You have labs here. I'm sure it's not in-house right now. It will take time to develop. But the labs are offering quadruple here. So the first thing is the aneuploidy marker in the first trimester. So as I said, I would not be talking about this because I thought it will be covered. But so that's the nuchal translucency, nasal bone, TR, tricuspid regurgitation, ductus venosus, and facial angle. But what we really need to understand here is that for all practical purposes, the only thing that is actually counted into risk calculation by most of the labs is only nuchal translucency. First trimester nasal bone, even if it is absent, right? First of all, if you do at 11 weeks, it is absent, it has no significance. You do and you repeat, it might appear later. And even if it is absent, so nasal bone absence in the first trimester is not as strong a marker as it is in the second trimester. So for all practical purposes, in the 11 to 14 week scan, a good NT, which you should be seeing, is how is what really matters. So once you've done the ultrasound, you can do a combined risk assessment using the serum biochemistry and the ultrasound parameters. And the result is what is the combined test, which has a very good detection rate. Now the next question would be when you should do the test. A patient comes to you at 11 weeks, patient comes to you at 13 weeks. So what is an ideal time to do the test? So the problem is that the NT is best done after 12 weeks, right? Because you know the baby is bigger. But PAP is best done at 10 weeks. Okay, so that's the thing. So you have see the best detection rate for PAP A is in the 10 to 11 weeks window. After that, it comes down. So the ideal practice is should be that you take the PAP A early and you do the ultrasound later. Okay, but what happens is the patient when comes for PAP A might not come back with an NT report. So that is what happens, and most of the labs would say before taking a biochemistry that show us the NT report so that they can give a value. Right, so that's the practical difficulty. But otherwise, if you see, ideally PAP A is early and NT is late. So these are some of the values that you should know, that in Down syndrome, NT is increased, beta HCG is increased, and PAP A is low. So there is literally no practical significance of a raised PAP A. PAP A is generally low in all of the aneuploidies that we see, and it is also low in preeclampsia and suspected FGR. So a low PAP A beyond aneuploidy is also a marker for preeclampsia. So when we are looking at the Down syndrome, at the aneuploidy report, don't just look at the final risk, look at the individual MOMs. If the PAP A is less than 0.3 MOM at any time, there is some problem, either aneuploidy or preeclampsia. So look at the PAP A reports. In trisomy 18, beta HCG also becomes lower. And in 13, beta HCG and PAP A are also lower. And you see NT is actually higher in 18 versus 21 and 13. So integration of tests, the only thing that I would like to say is that be in the current scenario, unless you have platforms which can, in the same labs which can integrate first and second trimester tests, we do not offer integrated tests. Right? So what we practically offer is only if the patient has come to us in the first trimester, do a combined screen. If the patient has come to in the second trimester, do a quadruple screen. So that is the practical thing to follow. So these are the detection rates of various tests that we are doing. And if you see that for a fixed false positive rate, the combined test has a detection rate of 85%, which is just fairly high. So you see, and if you do a quad, it is 80%. So for all practical purposes, our situation is first trimester combined, second trimester do a quad, right? So that makes it simpler. NIPT is another test which would be covered by Dr. Vatsala, but it is a useful screening test. It is still a screening test and its utility has various utility in various situations. Now, if the test, you have done the test, so first before doing the test, do a pre-test counseling. You tell them that this is a screening test. If the test comes positive, you would need further testing. The fetus is at, so if the test result comes negative, tell them that the fetus is at low risk of Down syndrome. However, it does not exclude the possibility of Down syndrome. It do not tell that your baby is normal. Just say that the test result is low risk. And provide a pre-test and post-test risk. After a low risk, अब combine हमने कर दिया तो उसके बाद do not go and offer quad. Right? First trimester combined screening we have done. Discharge the patient from an aneuploidy screening protocol. Just do a second trimester ultrasound. Now, if it is screen positive, then say that there is increased risk of Down syndrome. It's not definitive. Tell them the numbers that this was your pre-test risk. This is your post-test risk. And then offer them further testing, which could be a secondary screening, right? Secondary screening by NIPT or cell-free DNA. There is no secondary biochemical screening. If combined test is positive, there is no role of doing a quadruple test, right? So there is no secondary biochemical screening. Secondary screening is only with NIPT. Or you do a diagnostic test. In the secondary screening, again, if the cfDNA is negative, discharge from screen. If the cfDNA is positive, go for a diagnostic test, right? In the diagnostic test, you can do CVS or amnio. So again, biochemical marker screening test should not be repeated at any cost. But before you interpret any test, again recheck the gestational age by checking the CRL, because gestational age is one of the biggest factors because of which the test reports can come abnormal. A few things about the second trimester screening. Well, what is the timing? Is between 16 to 18 weeks and 6 days. This optimizes the test for both Downs and neural tube defects. Allow ample time for follow-up of pregnancies. Sometimes if the patient is late, you can offer these tests even up to 22 weeks and 6 days depending on the lab. Right? So even if the patient has come to you at say 19 weeks, 20 weeks, you can still offer a quadruple test and it will give you a lot of information because this is one test with a high detection rate. So how to do is that the blood sample should be centrifuged within 1 hour and the serum should be kept refrigerated. It should be received by the testing laboratory within a week of being drawn. So whatever lab you are sending, it should be a good lab and they should do a proper processing of samples. Otherwise, your test figures will be abnormal. How does these values change? So you see, as the gestation advances, the beta HCG is going to come down. Inhibin A will increase, your AFP will increase, and estriol will increase with gestational age. So this is what normally happens to your analyte levels. So here we are not even talking about affected pregnancies. This is normal distribution. So your lab, they should have these values, distribution of its levels in unaffected and affected pregnancies. So even if they do not have too many affected pregnancies, they should have the reference values of what they are sampling for normal patients at different gestations for their own standards. So they should have this distribution, which should show that in affected pregnancies, the beta HCG is increasing, the AFP is decreasing, and estriol is decreasing. So as we discussed in the first trimester, what happens in the second trimester is HCG and inhibin is increasing in Down syndrome, AFP and estriol is decreasing. Similarly, in 18, all of them are decreasing. And similarly, in 13, HCG and inhibin A increase and AFP and estriol is decreasing. So these are some of the gross things that we need to remember, that in Down syndrome, HCG and inhibin A will increase, while in 18 and 13, they either do not change or they decrease. So these are some of the values that we should know. Now, for quadruple, what should be the cutoff? You know, like for first trimester combined, we take a cutoff of 1 in 250. For quadruple, see, the cutoff is a kind of a situation between whether you want to increase the detection rate or you want to increase the false positive. So if you take a cutoff of 1 in 250, your detection rate is 84 and the false positive rate is higher of 5.7. But if you take a cutoff of 1 in 100, the detection rate will come down and the false positive also comes down. Right? So generally for quadruple, we can take a cutoff of 1 in 100. Right? So for the second trimester, quadruple test. Now, there are certain factors which can affect the second trimester quadruple, like race, gestational age is one of the most important factors. previous false positive, IVF and smoking. So you see all the reports when you are filling the form, this is the most important thing that we need to understand, that accurate gestational age, diabetes, smoking, IVF conception should be entered. So you see, true gestational age is important because, say for example, in this particular page, the patient's gestational age was calculated to be 18 weeks based on her LMP and 16 weeks based on an ultrasound scan. So if it was 18 weeks, then it was abnormal. But when it was recalculated to be 16 weeks, the AFP became normal. So you see, as we saw that the levels vary with gestation. So this is the importance of an accurate estimation of gestational age, which would affect your values. Again, maternal weight would affect the serum markers. In IVF pregnancy, beta-HCG and inhibin A are increased, something like a Down syndrome. So we need, their values are to be adjusted for IVF pregnancies and it should be mentioned. Similarly, smoking, again AFP and inhibin A are higher and beta-HCG and PAP A are lower. So these again should be mentioned. Diabetes, AFP is decreased by 20%, and in type 1 diabetes also AFP is reduced by 10%, whether you are on diet or you are on, whether you are in insulin or oral hypoglycemics. So another thing is something called the odds of being affected if your test rate is positive. So this is a value which is very important for you to counsel your patients. Now, if the test has come positive, say the quadruple test has come positive, so the patient will ask me, kya hai mere bacche ko bilkul hai kya Down syndrome? So then you can say that it is your odds are 1 in 32, like, you know, 32 times more chance that you are going to be, your child is going to be affected by Down syndrome. So for quadruple it is 1 in 32, so for triple it is 1 in 49, and first trimester combined it is 1 in 22. So that's why combined test is a better test. You know, the chances, because it detects more often. So just a few examples of cases. So again, reinforcing that you should note down the age of the mother nicely when you are sending the sample for a test. Gestational age should be noted down, previous history of a child with Down syndrome, and adjust moms according to weight, ethnicity, ART, twins, diabetes and smoking. So all these factors should be entered in the form properly for a proper interpretation. So now, see, these are some of the values that you will see. Diabetes. See, here you will see diabetes, weight, twins, IVF, smoking, previous trisomy, and sampling date. So this is the importance and age at the time of sampling. Again, ultrasound CRL, date by gestational age, and ultrasound by CRL. So these are the factors that should be mentioned. So now in this pregnancy, in this patient, it was found that the MOM, PAP-A MOM is 0.14. So this is normal, this is abnormal. This is normal, abnormal? Okay, so at the back, are you clear? Abnormal? So less than 0.3 is abnormal. So we see that it is abnormal. So first you see the factors that has been entered, gestational age has been entered correctly. Then you see what are the moms, and then you come and see the risk. So when they saw the risk, it was like the combined risk for one in trisomy is 1 in 403 for biochemistry, and for 13 and 18, it is 1 in 91. So now 1 in 403, is it normal or is it abnormal? 1 in 403, we take a cutoff of 250. 1 in 250. So it is what we call is an intermediate risk. Intermediate risk. 1 in 1000 is like low risk. Okay. So now I'm timing it. We have 2 minutes. Yeah. So the thing is that, so combined risk is, however, is 1 in 91. So here the trisomy risk is intermediate and the combined risk is high. Right? So, combined risk for 13, 18 is high. So, in this situation, because it's more than 1 in 100, you can offer an amniocentesis. But interestingly, what this person did is that they repeated the test from some other lab after 1 week, and they said now that the trisomy risk is 1 in 10,000. Is it a good thing or a bad thing? Did they do the correct thing or not? They repeated the test after 1 week. So basically, again, as I said, biochemistry should not be repeated. If you change the gestational age, then the things become different. So once, and still your doubt will not go. So once a biochemistry has come positive, do something else, secondary screening or definitive. And in the end, I would just like to say that there was this patient who was a doctor, 39-year-old, IUI conception, DADC twin, vanishing twin at 7 weeks. They first did NT scan from one place, and then NT scan from the second place. Both times uterine PI was high, uterine artery Doppler was high. They did not start aspirin. They did a dual test at 13 weeks. Again a dual test, they repeated. Twice they did a dual test again. So this is like the kind of, you know, how we are tempted to do the test again and test. But they were not satisfied. So they did NIPT. It came out to be low risk. And then they again did a triple screen. So just because the tests are available, we should not be doing the tests, right? Most importantly, we should know how to interpret and what steps to be followed. So this is a chart in the end to be followed. Desirable screening protocol. Antenatal screening in the first trimester. If the screen is positive more than 1 in 250, then you refer to a fetal medicine person. You can offer NIPT or invasive testing. If the screen is negative, forget about it. Just do a level 2 scan. If the screen is intermediate between 1 in 250 to 1 in 1000, you refer for a genetic person, fetal medicine, offer contingent screening, which could be again NIPT, or you could think of doing a genetic sonogram also. If the patient comes to you in the second trimester, offer a quadruple test. If she is screen positive, again offer NIPT or invasive. If she is screen negative, then discharge from screening, just offer a level 2 scan and discharge for screening protocol for a routine antenatal checkup. So take home points, offer prenatal screening to all women. The first trimester combined test is the best screening option. Maternal plasma cell-free DNA test is a screening test, not a diagnostic test. It has a higher sensitivity and it can be offered as a secondary screening test after positive biochemistry. Women may choose to have a diagnostic test. If a woman is screen negative, fetus is at low risk of Down syndrome and no further testing is required. Thank you so much.